potential data gathering.
Yes.
You have to be careful when you say what and where you say it. And I think many are feeling this way. Here on location, I think it's better not to say too much.
And it's Friday. David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart weigh the congressional response to Russian aggression toward Ukraine and the ongoing politics of gun violence in the United States. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us. Consumer Cellular.
John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
President Biden said today he believes Russia's President Vladimir Putin has made the decision to further invade Ukraine and that it will likely happen in the coming days. Before Mr. Biden's remarks at a late-day news conference, U.S. officials said even more Russian troops have arrived at the Russia-Ukraine border in recent days. They join 150,000 already on station, who the U.S. says are poised to attack. And as Nick Schifrin tells us, the U.S. fears the Russians and their allies may be in the initial phase of sparking a new and more brutal invasion.
If war in Ukraine's about to begin, U.S. officials fear it could start with an event like this. In the eastern city of Donetsk, controlled by Russian-backed separatists, local authorities showed off what they called the pro-Russian local military leader's car destroyed by a bomb. Authorities allowed local cameramen to film residents loading buses to flee across the border into Russia. And a military leader of the self-proclaimed separatist republic, Eduard Basurin, blamed the Ukrainian government.
The armed units of Ukraine are deliberately trying to instill fear and panic among the civilians of our republic by targeting vital infrastructure.
But open-source researchers say this video by the Donetsk leader reportedly recorded today was actually filmed 2 days ago. And today, President Biden called their claims deceptive and a possible pretext for Russian invasion.
All these are consistent with the playbook the Russians have used before, to set up a false justification to act against Ukraine. As of this moment, I'm convinced he's made the decision. We have reason to believe that.
But Russian President Vladimir Putin today said the Ukrainian government must negotiate with separatist leaders.
All Kyiv needs to do is sit at the negotiation table with Donbas representatives to resolve the conflict. And the earlier that happens, the better. Unfortunately, right now we see the situation escalating.
The U.S. and Kyiv say Russian-backed separatists are the aggressors, targeting this army checkpoint this morning and what Ukrainian police say was this residential building last night. Ukrainian Armed Forces Commander Valery Valuzhny.
We can't rebut all fabrications, the number of which is growing exponentially and is produced by enemy propaganda during these tough days.
The tough days have included cyber attacks that took down the websites of Ukraine's two largest banks and the foreign and defense ministries. Today, Anne Neuberger, Deputy National Security Advisor for Cyber, blamed the Russian government.
While of limited impact, this recent spate of cyber attacks in Ukraine
are consistent with what a Russian effort could look like in laying the groundwork for more disruptive cyber attacks accompanying a potential further invasion.
Senior U.S. officials say that invasion could come at any minute because more Russian troops have arrived in the last few days and are in a heightened readiness. Meanwhile, NATO tried to demonstrate unity. In Munich, Vice President Kamala Harris led a day of diplomacy with the NATO Secretary General and Baltic leaders.
The focus for us in working together is to further coordinate.
But the rhetoric doesn't match all of the reality. Germany refuses to provide Ukraine lethal weapons, a policy Foreign Minister Annalena Baerbock defended.
We are saying we are not selling weapons to everybody in the world, but only to our partners, NATO partners and European Union partners.
But the mayor of Kyiv, Vitaly Klitschko, pushed back.
We need right now defensive weapon. We're ready to defend our families, our states, our cities, our citizens. We need support.
Back in Kyiv today, a memorial honoring the Heavenly Hundred, martyrs of the 2014 conflict between two neighbors. This city has seen tragedy and now fears more. Officials today say they have plans to evacuate nearly the entire city should it come to that. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. Police in Canada arrested at least 100 protesters and towed away trucks in an effort to break up Ottawa's three-week-long siege. Truckers have occupied the capital city to demonstrate against Canada's COVID-19 restrictions. Authorities in neon green marched through the streets while tow truck operators hooked up vehicles blocking traffic, but some protesters were undeterred.
I'm willing to take it all the way, and by all the way, I mean dropping to my knees, putting up a peace sign, and they'll have to remove me at that point. I've protested peacefully the whole time I've been here.
Ottawa police said they're prepared to work around the clock if necessary to remove the more than 300 trucks. The U.S. Supreme Court has agreed to hear the Biden administration's appeal of the Trump-era Remain in Mexico policy. It requires asylum seekers to wait in Mexico before their U.S. immigration hearings. Lower court rulings forced President Biden to reinstate the policy after he tried suspending it. A final decision is expected by late June. The National Archives today confirmed it found classified national security information in the boxes of documents former President Trump took to his Mar-a-Lago home. That raises further questions about whether he followed record-keeping laws after leaving office. The agency referred the matter to the Justice Department. A judge sentenced the former suburban Minneapolis police officer who killed Dante Wright, Kim Potter, to 2 years in prison today. That was notably less than the standard manslaughter sentence of around 7 years. Potter fatally shot Wright, a 20-year-old black motorist, during a routine traffic stop last April. Special correspondent Fred DeSam Lazaro has our story.
Before today's sentencing in a downtown Minneapolis courtroom, Dante Wright's mother spoke tearfully about her son.
She took our baby boy with a single gunshot through his heart. She shattered mine.
In December, Potter was convicted of first and second degree manslaughter. She fatally shot Wright last April when she said she confused her handgun for a taser. The killing sparked protests and clashes with police. Today, Potter addressed Wright's family.
Katie, I understand a mother's love, and I am sorry I broke your heart. My heart is broken for all of you.
In handing down her sentence, Judge Regina Chu compared Potter's crime to Derek Chauvin's killing of George Floyd, as well as the 2017 shooting of a white woman by a black Minneapolis police officer, Mohammed Noor, who received a far longer sentence.
Officer Potter made a mistake that ended tragically. She never intended to hurt anyone. Her conduct cries out for a sentence significantly below the guidelines.
After the sentence was handed down, Dante Wright's family and supporters expressed outrage.
Kim Potter murdered my son. And he died April 11th. Today, the justice system murdered him all over again. This is the problem with our justice system today. White women tears trumps.
Wow.
Trumps justice. And I thought my white women tears would be good enough because they're true and genuine.
Potter will serve 2/3 of her time, about 16 months in prison. The rest will be on parole. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Fred DeSanlazaro.
California Governor Gavin Newsom is taking a legal play from Texas's abortion law to allow people to sue gun makers and sellers. The state legislature unveiled the bill today in an attempt to restrict the sale of assault-style guns. The Texas abortion law allows private citizens to sue abortion providers and has survived several legal challenges, which is what Newsom hopes for the gun bill. A winter storm is wreaking havoc for commuters in the Midwest. Traffic on Interstate 65 in Indiana ground to a standstill this morning. Treacherous conditions caused multiple trucks to jackknife off the road. It opened later this evening. And a 17-mile stretch of Interstate 39 in Illinois remained shut down for a second day after a 100-vehicle pileup during blinding snow. Meanwhile, a second major storm to hit northern Europe this week has killed at least 9 people and left tens of thousands without power. It brought strong waves to the southern coast of the United Kingdom. Winds gusting more than 100 miles per hour ripped off sections of London's O2 Arena and even toppled the spire of an English church. U.S. Congressman Jim Hagedorn died last night after a 3-year battle with kidney cancer. The conservative Republican represented southern Minnesota since 2019. Jim Hagedorn was 59 years old. And at the Winter Olympics in Beijing, American skier David Wise will go for his 3rd Olympic gold medal in the men's freestyle halfpipe tonight. And in women's bobsled, Alana Myers-Taylor will go for her 2nd medal. After earning silver in an earlier race, that medal made her the oldest American woman to win a medal in a Winter Olympics. Still to come on the NewsHour, the controversy around Russian figure skating highlights the pressures and mental health challenges for athletes. Snowboarder Nick Baumgartner discusses winning gold at the Winter Olympics. David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart consider the week's political news, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
At the 3-day security conference that began in Munich today, U.S. and NATO leaders aim to further unify Western nations in their efforts to combat Russian aggression against Ukraine. Nick Schifrin has more now on the European response with a key European diplomat.
And joining me now is Germany's ambassador to Washington, Emily Haber. Ambassador Haber, welcome to the NewsHour. Earlier, we heard President Biden said that he believes Putin has decided to invade. Senior NATO officials are telling me they fear the invasion could come tomorrow. Do you agree?
We have been briefed and informed and been sharing information among allies within NATO, with the United States, throughout these past weeks. There's no day when we don't exchange information about the latest knowledge and the latest assessments. So, given the monumental military buildup around Ukraine, which is the biggest concentration of military forces since the end of the Cold War, we have severe grounds for worrying about a massive threat.
The pretext, of course, is what many people here have been talking about. We showed earlier what separatists in Donetsk, in eastern Ukraine, an area that they control, called a car bomb in the capital city of Donetsk. Are we in the middle of a Russian provocation? And if it's a false flag, is that what is going to precede some kind of military action?
It is a possibility, but it's difficult at this stage to pinpoint exactly what sort of pretext would be used. And then I would also point your attention to the fact that even though there is a wide open gap between what Russia claims it wants, diplomacy, and what it actually does on the ground, and that is concentrating military forces, that the door to diplomacy hasn't entirely been closed. We have every responsibility to pursue the diplomatic avenue, but obviously it takes two to tango. For the moment, there is still the upcoming meeting, if it then happens, between the Secretary of State and the Russian Foreign Minister. There is the NATO-Russia Council, for which we've suggested a meeting. There is the OECD track. There is the Normandy format. So the door to diplomacy hasn't been slammed shut.
You follow very closely, and in fact, you've been in the middle, in some ways, of the debate in Congress about the timing of sanctions. You've spoken to congressional leaders about this. At this point, do you believe that Russia should be sanctioned now, as these events are unfolding very rapidly in eastern Ukraine? And should that not include the possibility of pulling Nord Stream 2, the German-Russian pipeline, even before this invasion begins?
Well, that's an equation. Look, if you adopt punitive sanctions because of what has already happened, you slam the door shut to a change of behavior that we actually want to produce by deterring Russia from going down that road in the first place. So while putting sanctions on the shelf for Russia clearly to see what will happen if it invades Ukraine, if we adopt the sanctions now, there's no incentive whatsoever for Russia to reconsider.
And are you confident that Moscow understands what would happen to Nord Stream 2 if tanks and soldiers start crossing that border?
Well, the German Chancellor Olaf Scholz has been in Moscow earlier this week, and he clearly said in a press conference that the Russians knew it, and everyone knew what was going to happen should the Russians invade Ukraine.
Well, with all due respect, Olaf Scholz did not use the words Nord Stream 2 when discussing that. So he has been a little bit oblique. So are you saying that perhaps privately he's less oblique?
He has responded to a question at this press conference that related to Nord Stream 2 and a former chancellor. And it was in this context that he said that Germany would adopt massive sanctions in lockstep with its allies, and the Russians knew exactly what was going to happen. I might add, too, that in the margins of the Munich Security Conference, in a discussion with Secretary of State Blinken, the German foreign minister said that all options were going to be on the table, and that included Nord Stream 2.
Washington and London have been very aggressive at revealing Russian military plans, they say are Russian military plans, and U.S. and Western intelligence assessments. U.S. officials say that they're trying to remove Putin's element of surprise. Do you agree?
Communication strategies can be a difficult equation because you need to weigh the benefits against the potential costs. Calling Putin out and producing clarity and transparency for the entire world to see, including for Russians, to see what is going on and what Russia is doing and where the responsibility lies has clearly a benefit insofar as the surprise element is no more with Putin and the initiative is no more with him. The initiative is with those who actually produce the transparency for everyone to see.
Emily Haber, Germany's ambassador to the United States, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
This is the closing weekend of the Winter Olympics that have in many ways been overshadowed by larger concerns, such as China's human rights record and doping allegations. We're going to look at much of this tonight, starting with the conduct of the Russian squad. Yesterday, Russian ice skater Kamila Valieva failed to score a medal, then was berated by her coach immediately afterward. Many were disturbed by how this unfolded and worried about the pressures on the athletes. Lisa Desjardins begins our coverage.
The women's ice skating competition has been a particularly ugly moment for the games this week. For more about it, I'm joined by Stephanie Apstein of Sports Illustrated. She's covering the games right there in Beijing. Stephanie, let's start with that ladies' competition that we in the United States saw last night. I don't think I've ever seen anything like it. Can you help take us through those ugly moments, Russian skaters being treated very sternly, raising a lot of controversy, a great deal of emotion there at the end? What happened?
Yeah, I don't think I've ever seen anything quite like it either. It was really hard to watch. Kamila Valieva, who had been the favorite going into it and was competing under this cloud of doping suspicion, struggled dramatically in her free skate. She fell twice. She stepped out of jumps. I mean, it was really a mess. She was crying by the time she came off the ice. And the first person who greeted her was her coach, Terry Tuparitse, who basically just started yelling at her immediately, asking her why she had given up, basically why she wasn't trying harder. So understandably, Valieva continues sobbing, and then they announce that she has finished fourth, meaning that her teammate Anna Shcherbakova is going to win. Shcherbakova is alone at that moment that she finds it out. She's sitting there just sort of stunned, looking not terribly happy. The second place finisher, Alexandra Trusova, is sobbing as well because she completed a very challenging routine that she thought should have won. So she is weeping. She's yelling that she hates skating. She hates the sport. She hates her coaches. She never wants to do it again. Everybody has a gold medal except for her. It was really, really an upsetting scene to see these three teenagers all having really big emotions, all for pretty upsetting reasons.
As you say, these are young women who really have put most of the rest of their lives on hold for this sport and for the Olympic Games. Thomas Bach, the president of the International Olympic Committee, was asked about this, and he did show some concern. Is there any way the Olympic Committee can change how these skaters are treated or how any athlete is treated by coaches like this?
Well, I think the International Olympic Committee tends to say sort of vaguely the right thing and then not take a lot of action to back it up. And that is what I would guess is happening here. Thomas Bach did say that he was concerned, but none of this should have been a surprise to him. I mean, there has been talk about this coach, this program for years. Certainly Russians doping is not new, and it's his organization that has sort of let them skate, if you will. So I think there probably are things that the IOC could be doing, such as, you know, formal investigations. I think it could be separating itself a little bit from the higher court that sort of oversees things. I mean, a lot of the people who sit on the court also sit on the IOC, making it not really an independent body at all. They're all so entwined that it's hard to see anything real getting done here.
As the kind of bureaucracy of the sport has trouble dealing with it, we've seen what's happening with the skaters here in that they're all pushing the limits. You know, the second place finishers, you mentioned Alexandra Trusova, I believe she landed 5 quadruple jumps. I want to ask you, what do we know about what that's doing to these young skaters' bodies? And is sport just going too far, too demanding on these skaters at this point for their own physical health?
Yeah, that Trusova routine was actually, she landed 5 quads, which is the same number as the men's champion, Nathan Chen. So that's sort of a wild statistic if you think about the difference in the male body and the female body. And part of the problem is that once these girls' bodies mature into women's bodies, they really can't generate the kind of force required to land these quadruple jumps. They have sort of the wrong muscle to fat ratio as they would naturally as they age. And so that also sets up really backward incentives in that if your goal is to create skaters who can do these sort of incredible rotations, what you want are children, and you want them to be as skinny as possible because the less they weigh, the easier it is for them to launch themselves into the air. So you end up with situations like this one in which Russian skaters have talked about not really being allowed to eat very much. Some said they didn't even drink water during the Olympics because it's all about keeping their weight down so that they can produce these jumps. And these are issues that the skating community has faced for a long time, this sort of artistry versus athleticism question. And I think this is sort of the natural endpoint of that is, If you want to see them do these jumps, the way to do it is pretty unhealthy. It's pretty bad for their bodies.
And in fact, you wrote that you think it's time for figure skating to set an age limit. Do you think that would
help? Yeah, I think it would help. The age limit is currently 15, which, as I think we've seen, is low both from a physical perspective, as I mentioned, and then also just sort of the horror of what we saw at the event. These are children. And the IOC sort of nods at this issue by having a protected person class through the World Anti-Doping Agency that basically says 15-year-olds are too young to make decisions for themselves, and therefore they shouldn't be prosecuted quite the same way. Well, if they're too young to know what they're doing, then maybe we shouldn't have them at the Olympics. So yeah, I suggest, and a lot of other people have been talking about, maybe it's time to suggest that they all be 18. This is an adult sport for adults. It would make it less likely that these are children being taken advantage of. It would force these organizations to find a way to extend the careers of these athletes. Mariah Bell, who is a 25-year-old US skater, pointed out that she's really been able to make a profession out of this, and that for a lot of her younger peers, they'll do it for 2 years, maybe at the senior elite level. They'll compete at one Olympics, and then that's it. And they're retired at age 17, and they have back problems, and they have to sort of move on with their lives. And is that really what we want for these people? I think it probably isn't.
A fascinating and sometimes very difficult Olympic Games. Thank you so much for joining us to talk about it, Stephanie Apstein of Sports Illustrated.
Thanks for having me.
Unlike 1.4 billion Chinese citizens, international athletes competing at the Winter Olympics do have free access to the internet. But through 12 days of sport, no Olympic athlete has criticized the host country for what advocates call a horrific human rights record. Nick Schifrin is back with more on what's keeping the athletes from speaking out.
From skiers' Dirty Dancing to something strange in the neighborhood. Who you gonna call?
Olympics feels like a movie right now.
So many COVID tests, it felt like the Empire swabs back.
They have this machine here that, like, just knows who you are.
For 2 weeks, 3,000 mostly millennial athletes descended on the Beijing Olympics and posted online their lives.
Silver medalist.
Their success. Their relief on social media sites that, for the other 21 million people in Beijing and 1.4 billion people in China, are blocked. Authorities drilled a small hole for athletes in China's great internet firewall shortly after winning the games.
During the 2022 Winter Games, we will comprehensively open access to the internet for all customers, including at the competition venues, where athletes stay, and other areas.
But for athletes, it's access with Chinese characteristics, as Olympics Committee Deputy Director Yang Shu warned last month through an interpreter.
Any behavior or speeches that is against the Olympic spirit, especially against the Chinese laws and regulation, are also subject to certain punishment.
Beijing has long used domestic laws to punish its critics, and that history has pushed athletes to stay silent.
We were given, like, a course, very brief course about just the difference of, you know, our laws and then the laws of the country we're going to. The freedom of speech thing is a little harsher in China.
Joanne Firestall-Reed and Deirdre Irwin are biathletes, a combination of cross-country skiing and shooting. We interviewed them before the games.
Personally, it's not a place to, like, make huge statements and try to criticize. You need to be sensitive about when you bring stuff up and why you're bringing it up.
On the night of the opening ceremonies, Chinese authorities dragged off reporter Shor Dan Das, who later said the police had stopped him multiple times. And after winning gold in this year's luge, German Natalie Geisenberger, a former critic of Beijing's human rights, self-censored.
You have to be careful when you say what and where you say it. And I think many are feeling this way. Here on location, I think it's better not to say too much.
Irwin and Reed said Team USA advised leave electronics at home.
Everybody is telling us to bring burner phones and burner laptops and, you know, hide all of our personal data.
There's the threat that the government may be eavesdropping on you, and they can do that in all sorts of ways, from the cell network to the Wi-Fi in the hotel, the fact that they can access data from platforms directly.
Ron Diebert is the founder and director of Citizen Lab, a Canadian cybersecurity research group. Last month, Citizen Lab researchers found holes in My 2022, the Chinese app required for all athletes that collects medical and travel history and passports.
the encryption that was used to protect the traffic that's going from the application out to the internet was done in a way that left open the possibility of interception of any content. What we have seen empirically through reverse engineering and testing literally thousands of Chinese-based mobile applications is that they build into their platforms some kind of censorship, some kind of surveillance, and sometimes the coding is done in a sloppy fashion.
Initially, Beijing and the International Olympics Committee criticized Citizen Lab's research and defended the app. But then the app's developers fixed the bugs themselves.
Does that mean the athletes who are in China today participating in the Olympics and their data are safe?
No, it doesn't. You have to assume going into this environment that there's so many potential points of surveillance. There is a very broad national cybersecurity law in China that gives the authorities permission to access user data from technology platforms, largely without a warrant and without any discretion. They're required to turn that information over.
While it censors content at home, Beijing tries to use influencers to spread propaganda abroad. This Israeli visited cotton farms in Xinjiang, where the U.S. says China detained more than 1 million Uyghurs and forces them to work.
It's totally normal here. People are nice, doing their job, living their life.
And social media analysts say Beijing uses spam to camouflage the human rights realities. So-called spamouflage pumps out thousands of messages targeting Chinese critics, including those who called for Olympics boycotts. As the spokesperson for China's Olympic Committee, Bokog, said yesterday,
the so-called issue of forced labor in Xinjiang is a lie fabricated by some forces with ulterior motives. We oppose any behavior that politicizes sports.
Today, IOC President Thomas Bach backed Beijing up.
Both organizations, Bokog and the IOC, have restated their unequivocal commitment to remain politically neutral.
Which means once the Olympics ends, the small crack in the Great Firewall will close again. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
Despite the problems and criticism around the Olympics, these past 2 weeks still have provided their share of incredible accomplishments and powerful moments to celebrate. Amna Nawaz talks with one of the members of Team USA who brought home gold.
Judy, Nick Baumgartner has not only won a gold medal, but he did it as the oldest American athlete to compete at the Beijing Games. He clinched gold in the mixed snowboard cross last weekend, along with his 36-year-old teammate, Lindsay Jacobellis. That came just days after a disappointing elimination in the men's individual snowboard cross. This was Baumgartner's fourth Winter Olympics and his first Olympic medal. Nick Baumgartner joins me now. Nick, welcome to the NewsHour. First and foremost, congratulations. Show us the bling. I know you got it close by.
Yeah, absolutely. We got it here. Unbelievable. It's just that so amazing. And I'm honored to be able to bring this back here.
It's a thing of beauty. And I want to ask you about your journey to that in just a second. But Nick, take me to that moment. Just that moment, you watched Lindsay cross the finish line and you knew you had finally won that gold medal. In that moment, what did it feel like?
Well, that moment I think was sweeter than it ever could have been, being what happened 2 days prior when I made a small mistake in the individual race where I was showing lots of speed and I got eliminated and didn't get to go to the medal rounds. And to me, for being my fourth Olympics, I don't know if I have another shot. So there was a lot riding on that. So my emotions came out. People got to see me do a very hard interview to do. And a lot of emotions came out. And me, I'm proud that those came out because everyone got to see what we go through as athletes. But when I got to sit there and watch Lindsay, it's no one better to have in the gate than the greatest snowboard cross racer of all time. She's the winningest snowboard cross racer ever. And to have her as my teammate lightens the load a little bit, makes it a little more fun. So you're enjoying yourself and you're riding better. And then when I got to the bottom and I got to watch her go, I knew it was going to take smart racing on that course because the snow came in and she shined and it was awesome. to be able to bring this home to my community has been so emotional. I got a hero's welcome, thousands of people in the streets for 60 miles to my house, following fire trucks, ambulance, city workers, all these people that have been there to support me. This is a dream come true, and the UP is shining gold right now.
Nick, I gotta tell you, one of the reasons people love you so much and have been cheering for you is because you put it all out there. You wear your heart on your sleeve. After you've lost in that individual race, you did, you cried in that interview, and you said something that stuck with a lot of people. You said, you know what, I'm 40 years old and I'm running out of chances. Now, I'm sure you've lost before. I'm sure losing is hard every time, but in that moment, why do you think it hit you so hard after that race?
I mean, it's just, you see that whole dream you've been chasing for 17 years, and you saw it slip through your hands. And I wasn't 100% aware that I was racing in a team race, because I didn't know that we had two teams. I thought we only had one. There was a chance we only had one team. And then my teammate, Jake Vetter, who did a great job in his first Olympics, he met the criteria to get that spot. And so I thought that was it. And every other Olympics I had that, I was able to say, well, next time, we're going to work harder, and next time. Next times are running out. I mean, I have an expiration date on this elite level athletics. And just to know that it might not happen, it crushed me. It crushed me. And I made so many sacrifices this past off season so that I could live with the decisions I made and the choices I made had I not made the Olympic team. But I made the Olympic team, and then it was to not just going. I wanted a medal. I wanted to chase that greatness, and I thought that chance was gone.
Nick, you've been snowboarding since you were 15 years old. Is that right? And this is not, it's not a full-time job, right? What did it take to get where you are now?
It took so many people supporting me. And like you said, this isn't my full-time job. Shocker, Olympic snowboarders don't always make a lot of money, especially in my discipline. And it's been very tough. But one thing that I've learned from being from the Midwest and from the Upper Peninsula is work ethic. I was taught that from my family. And I've been a construction worker. That's how I pay for this and I fund this dream. I'm a concrete worker, contractor in the summers, and it allows me to work my butt off and save my money up and use that money when it's too cold and there's too much snow to pour concrete. So it was like the two perfect jobs, other than both of them completely destroy my body. So it makes it even harder to keep up with these kids. But for me, there's no excuses. If you want it, you got to go and get it. And that's the only way that I was able to help fund this dream. And then the support. My support system is better than any Olympic athlete I've ever met. And when they come from these Olympic hotbeds, it's not that big of a deal. When you come from the Upper Peninsula, from a town of 3,000 people, it is a big deal. And the amount of support to help you through those lows, to keep you level-headed on those highs, I owe it to the entire community of the Upper Peninsula of Michigan.
You get back home, you're wearing that medal. Your 17-year-old son, Landon, greets you at the airport, gives you an enormous hug. What does he say to you?
Man, he just tells me how proud he is. And I mean, just to see him, I didn't know he was going to be at the airport. I knew there was going to be people and I was going to have family there, but I didn't know he was coming down. And he did a good job of surprising his dad. And I walked out and I was like, come on, man, you've cried enough. Hold it together. Let's try to be able to speak words. And then he walked out from behind the crowd and out they came. And as a dad, it's pretty awesome.
So, Nick, what's next? World Championships next year?
I think we do the same thing we did this year. We bust our butt. I live in and out of my van in the summer because my commute to the gym that I train at is an hour and a half away. So me and my dog and my son will be doing some camping and working out and training, getting ready so that I can give it a full run. I don't want to live with the regret of, could you have gotten a world championship right after that gold medal? And I don't want to have to think about whether I could or I couldn't have because of what I did. We're going to give it the best shot, and how it happens is how it happens.
Well, I think it's fair to say you have a lot more new fans cheering you on every step of the way. Gold medalist Nick Baumgartner joining us tonight. Oh. Nick, congratulations again. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys. And thanks to everyone for the support and all the new fans and people that are in my corner. It's unbelievable for a small town kid.
And now to the analysis of Brooks and Capehart. That is New York Times columnist David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart, columnist for The Washington Post. Hello to both of you. So good to see you. But we start again, Jonathan, with a sobering story that we've been following all week, and that's Ukraine. Late today, President Biden saying that he's now convinced that the Russians are going in, that they will further invade. He says the allies are united. There will be a devastating response. We also see here in Washington, in the United States, the two political parties seem to be united behind the Biden administration on this, except there was a small split this week over sanctions. But my question to you, Jonathan, is how unified do you think the two parties truly are when it comes to supporting the administration on Ukraine and Russia?
Sure, Judy, of all the issues we've been talking about since I've been a part of this for the last year, this is probably the one issue where there doesn't seem to be any daylight between Democrats and Republicans when it comes to talking about what consequences Vladimir Putin and Russia should suffer if, or as the president says, when he rolls over the border into Ukraine and attacks Ukrainian sovereignty. There was a kerfuffle over sanctions bill, but it wasn't one side saying, let's hit them with sanctions, and the other side saying, no, let's not. It was, hey, we just have two competing bills on what to do. There's no daylight between Democrats and Republicans on this, just as there doesn't seem to be any daylight between the United States and the Western Alliance about what to do and how to respond and with what to respond if or when Vladimir Putin invades Ukraine.
David, how do you see, is this real unity on this?
I think so. You know, last summer, Vladimir Putin wrote an article on why, claiming that Russia and Ukraine were the same country. It was basically an argument for Russia invading Ukraine. It's amazing how dictators, they're not subtle. They tell us what they're going to do, and now apparently they're going to do it. And so if you read that article, you could see why we are where we are. It's his belief that he has the right to conquer an independent nation. And in doing so, hope to throw the United States out of Europe, and in doing so, hope to create a kind of dangerous world that he thrives in. So the issues couldn't have been bigger, and they're not issues that particularly divide Americans or members of the Western Alliance. And so I do think there's going to be a lot of unity. There will be some people who worry on the left that this is part of American imperialism to get involved in Europe. There are some people on the right who like Vladimir Putin. They see him as a manly, socially conservative, authoritarian kind of guy who they kind of like. So I'm sure on either end there will be some. But among the mainstream of both parties, I think right now there's strong unity. The Biden administration has done an excellent job of rallying the Western Alliance. It's been a demonstration of why the world needs America to be a leader of the free world. Whether that will last as the costs ratchet up for all of us in the West, we'll see. But right now, it looks quite unified to me.
Jonathan, how much does it matter that the United States presents a united front at a time like this, a moment like this?
Well, I mean, the Western Alliance, as we're talking about, was, you know, the United States helped to create it. The United States and that Western Alliance have kept peace on the continent for more than 70 years. So it's vitally important that the United States be the leader in this. Also because, Judy, as we all know, we just came from 4 years of an administration that cast doubt on U.S. leadership in NATO, cast doubt on the need for NATO. A president who spent more time trying to curry favor with and establish a friendly relationship with Vladimir Putin and giving a stiff arm to America's longstanding allies in the West. So the fact that the United States is back, as President Biden said, I think it was at his first G7, I think the world is very happy that the traditional role of the United States is being adhered to by President Biden.
So, David, unity at a moment like this matters?
Yeah, I think so. You know, Vladimir Putin, Fiona Hill argued that Putin believes that America is where Russia was in the 1990s, that is to say, weak, retreating, poor leadership, And let's face it, all of us who have been covering this country have doubts about where the country is. But we're not dead yet, I guess I would say. You know, we are still have the only military that's really able to project power around the world. We still have a tradition of leading the Western Alliance. Emmanuel Macron thought Europe should go it alone. But I think we've seen over the last week that's not possible. We have to work together. And that's what's happening. And just in reference to what something Jonathan said, I shudder to think what would happen if Donald Trump was in office right now. You know, whether this would, how would we be reacting to Vladimir Putin? Donald Trump was never one to really go toe-to-toe with Vladimir Putin. I think he genuinely admires the man. And if he were in office right now, we'd be looking at a very difficult and very troubling situation.
We'll let that one settle in for just a moment. But I do want to ask both of you about a different subject, and that is guns. Jonathan, this week we saw a settlement between Remington, which is a major gun manufacturer, and the families of the Sandy Hook victims of 2012, that terrible massacre at an elementary school in Connecticut, $73 million. This is over a period of time. We've seen almost no federal action in the direction of gun control. And just this week, we saw the Justice Department file a suit against the state of Missouri over its relatively new law, loosening gun control, essentially moving in the direction of gun rights. What do you make of all this at this moment, at this time, and the politics of it?
Well, Judy, what I'm struck by is how victims of gun violence and people who really want some limits on access to guns, particularly guns that are considered weapons of war, how they're no longer cowering in the face of a very well-funded gun rights lobby, that they are now looking for ways to hold gun manufacturers accountable. The Newtown families figuring out a way to get around the inability to sue gun manufacturers directly and getting this settlement. You know, I'm in California right now, having done an interview with California Governor Gavin Newsom, who today announced a series of gun control or measures going after gun manufacturers, including one penned by Governor Newsom himself, to use the Texas anti-abortion law that the Supreme Court let go through while the case was pending, use that ability to give the opportunity for people to go after gun manufacturers in the way that Texas is allowing, you know, everyday people to go after people who provide abortion services. What it says to me is that these folks, folks who want, to do something about gun violence aren't going to take it anymore. And if I could just read one thing to you from what Governor Newsom said, and he literally said, quote, "I can't take it anymore. I'm sick and tired of saying thoughts and prayers. We have had enough, and we're going hard against these guys."
David, do you see real movement here in one direction or another when it comes to guns?
Yeah, I'm not sure I see that much movement. I was surprised the Sandy Hook families were able to succeed. The gun manufacturers have a law protecting them from liability, but they were able, as Jonathan said, to find a way in. And the way in was to emphasize marketing, that Remington used some marketing slogans that seemed to endorse the idea that these guns were for offensive purposes, not for self-defense. I assume no gun manufacturer will ever use an ad like that again, and they'll talk about self-defense. And so they may have closed off that one legal way to make themselves vulnerable. I still see deadlock. I mean, the Missouri rule is an absurdity. The Missouri rule essentially says Missourians don't have to obey by a federal law when it comes to Second Amendment. Now, I'm not a big legal scholar, but I do know the Constitution explicitly says that federal law takes precedence, has supremacy over state law. This is not advanced constitutional law. And so every legal expert expects the Missouri thing to go down. And what's happening in state legislatures on issue after issue is that people are passing laws they don't expect to be actually enacted. It's just a political statement. And so they're fundamentally unserious laws. So I'm sure that will get struck down. The blunt fact is that we have 250 million guns in this country. I don't know how, I don't see any political prospect of really reducing that number. And even in the last 2 years, the number of gun purchases has at times hit record levels.
You know, Judy, if I could add one more thing.
Sure.
What had Governor Newsom really incensed is that, to David's point about gun manufacturers and you know, Sandy Hook families going the marketing route, the governor was incensed that there is a new gun that's being targeted to kids for purchase by kids, not the AR-15, but it's being called the JR-15. And they're touting it as being lighter, and also on it is sort of an etching of a skull with a pacifier. They're marketing an assault weapon, or as the governor called it, a weapon of war to children. And this is also one of the things that Governor Newsom is trying to go after.
There's so many, it seems like every time we turn around, there's a new kind of gun that is being marketed. Only a couple of minutes left, but I do want to add, Jonathan, you're in California, but I'll start with David on this. Some glimmerings around the country in local races, David, that voters who had voted Democratic are having real problems with Democratic candidates right now. Three members of the San Francisco School Board kicked out of office. We've seen it in Virginia and a few other places. It's voters upset about COVID, about education issues, and more. But how worried, I guess, is my question, and I'm asking you to do this in just a minute or so. Should Democrats be right now about some of these frankly, surprising moves around the country?
It should be a five-alarm fire. The San Francisco, they defeated those people by like 72% to 79%. The two big issues are schools. San Francisco wanted to dismantle the magnet school, and crime. Crime is being talked about in my neighborhood, and defund the police put the Democrats in a terrible spot on this issue, as they did on this education issue.
And Jonathan, I mean, here in the District of Columbia, again, a very Democratic city, the mayor's popularity or favorability rating down over her handling of crime.
Right. And she's going to have to convince Washingtonians that she has that she's, you know, got it under control. But look, Democrats are always fretting about whether or not they are in good standing. It's good that David says it's a five-alarm fire, because maybe that will focus people in terms of focusing in on what needs to happen, as opposed to what those three San Francisco school board members were trying to do.
We'll come back to this one when we have some more time to talk. Thank you both. Jonathan Capehart joining us tonight from California. David Brooks, thank you.
Thanks, Judy.
As we close tonight, we wanted to take a different look at those affected by gun violence with some familiar music brought to us by an unlikely duo. We profile former Congresswoman Gabby Gifford's journey to retrain her brain after she was shot in 2011. Part of her routine includes playing her childhood instrument, the French horn. That report caught the eye of cellist Yo-Yo Ma, who then reached out to Gifford's to play together. Here they are rehearsing Simon and Garfunkel's Sound of Silence to honor the lives lost to gun violence each year. Thank you both. And that is the News Hour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here on Monday evening. For all of us at the PBS News Hour, thank you. Please stay safe and have a good weekend.
Major funding for the PBS News Hour has been provided by Consumer Cellular. BNSF Railway. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world. At Hewlett.org.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS NewsHour West. From WETA studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.